What about the idea of nutrient shedding? If you correct a deficiency too fast, can you make it worse?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Okay, Jeff Huseby says, do we know if the body initiates a shedding reaction when inundated with highly regulated substances, or what I assume are highly regulated substances like vitamins or minerals? The impetus for this question comes from my experiences taking both recommended and above recommended doses of things like magnesium, zinc, vitamin C, and even water, for example. Start with magnesium. I've had muscle cramps for years, and when I first heard that magnesium could be helpful for that, I tried what I thought was a reasonable dose. Don't remember exactly how much, it wasn't excessive, and noticed an opposite reaction. My muscles cramped even more. Next, zinc. I knew that zinc was good for immune function, so a few months ago, I took 40 milligrams one day. The result was an explosion of rhinitis, as if it hurt my immune function instead of helping it. Megadosing vitamin C makes me crave citrus fruits, and drinking large amounts of water dries out my skin. It seems like these reactions are signs of deficiency, which makes me wonder. Well, if you can respond to your question and clarify what you mean by shedding, it would help me, because I don't know what you mean by a shedding reaction. But it sounds from your elaboration like you're asking if inundating, if fixing a deficiency too fast can worsen it. In which case, I think the answer is no. There is some evidence for chronic use of a nutrient increasing the need for it. So, for example, there's some rebound scurvy that's been documented in some cases of vitamin C supplementation as a consequence of withdrawal. But that's not really what you're describing. You're sort of describing like a U-shaped curve between dose and the deficiency symptom, it sounds like. Okay, Jeff Huseby adds, rest of the question got cut off. If my body went into some kind of emergency shedding response, I still don't know what you mean by shedding response. In the presence of way more than it wanted or expected of those substances, resulting in a temporary deficiency, is this a known response? It would still help me if you clarify exactly what you mean by shedding response, but it sounds like what you mean is you take a megadose of the nutrient and the body is so scared of that nutrient that it gets rid of it and gets rid of more than what it had in the first place to cause you to be even more deficient. That sounds wildly improbable, and I definitely don't think that happens. And I've never seen anything to suggest that happens. But let me see if I can offer any explanation for the anecdotes that you give. So for magnesium, you say you've had muscle cramps for years, and when you first heard it was helpful, you tried what you thought was a reasonable dose, and your muscles cramped even more. Well, I mean, that to me sounds like maybe your muscle cramps weren't caused by magnesium deficiency. So it's certainly the case. And actually, I'm going to consult the cheat sheet and look at if I have it documented in here whether magnesium excess can alter levels of other things that can cause muscle cramps. So let's see. So, okay, so magnesium deficiency and magnesium excess can both cause hypocalcemia. And so a lot of the symptoms of magnesium deficiency that are attributable to the secondary hypocalcemia can be caused by magnesium excess. So that's one thing to consider. I don't have anything in here about it affecting other electrolyte levels, but that doesn't mean that it doesn't. So the way that magnesium deficiency causes muscle cramps is generally that calcium is the factor that stimulates muscle contraction, and magnesium is needed for the ATP-dependent removal of calcium from the area of the muscle where it causes muscular contraction. And so you get kind of a permanent muscular contraction. So I don't think hypocalcemia is implicated in those cramps. But it's possible that there's definitely roles for other electrolytes in muscle cramps. So, for example, sodium and potassium have roles in muscle cramps. And I suppose it's possible that there are other implications of magnesium in muscle cramps. For example, there could be a role acting on the control of the muscle by the nerve that I'm not aware of in terms of the most important mechanisms there. But I'm going to guess that you weren't deficient in magnesium and that was too much magnesium. And too much magnesium isn't necessarily determined by the dose. It's determined by your status plus the dose relative to your status. And also, if you have problems getting magnesium into cells, then supplementing with magnesium is even more likely to cause hypermagnesemia than if you don't have that problem. So you could simultaneously have... I notice every time I put my hand here, the glare on my face gets better. I got to find some way to do that doesn't require putting my hand there. So it is possible that you could be deficient in magnesium causing cramps, and supplementing magnesium because of deficient magnesium intracellular transport could cause hypermagnesemia, which messes with your electrolytes, which worsens cramps. But it's definitely not the case that you're shedding magnesium, getting rid of it in response to the supplementation. So in that case, I think the right thing to do would have been measure your red blood cell and serum magnesium to see if that's the right response to the cramps. And I guess this comes – so one of the issues with nutritional management is, you know, comprehensive nutritional screening could cost you a couple thousand dollars if you want to measure everything at once. So the question becomes, when does it make sense to actually do lab measurements, especially if they're not covered by insurance? Although if you get LabCorp, Quest, red blood cell magnesium, and serum magnesium ordered by the doctor in the right way, the insurance will probably cover it. Well, in this case, it clearly is making a difference in the actionable step you should be taking. So you're describing trying to fix it, what you think is a magnesium deficiency with magnesium making it worse. You know, the most reasonable conclusion is that you're not deficient in magnesium, and that you might be at risk of hypermagnesemia from the supplementation. And so that's an excellent reason to test your red blood cell and serum levels to try to figure that out. Next one is zinc. Zinc deficiency causes immune dysfunction, and zinc excess causes immune dysfunction. So there's nothing even paradoxical about that. The mechanisms are different. Zinc is needed for immune function, but so is copper. Zinc induces a copper deficiency at too high of a dose, and it's a well-demonstrated consequence of excessive zinc supplementation that it hurts immune function. So that's just doesn't require any further explanation. And then the last one is megadosing vitamin C makes you crave citrus fruits. Well, I don't know. I don't think craving citrus fruits is a symptom of vitamin C deficiency, really. So I'm not sure that that's good evidence that vitamin C is actually causing a vitamin C deficiency. And that probably has a lot more to do with how those tastes are wired together in your brain. And then drinking large amounts of water dries out my skin. Well, I'm not sure what the mechanism for that would be, but I don't think dry skin is I rarely think dry skin is ever a result of dehydration, unless you're thirsty. And if you're thirsty, you should drink more. The primary symptom of dehydration is thirst. If you're thirsty, you probably need to drink more water. If you're not thirsty, you probably don't need to drink more water. And there are exceptions to that. But if your skin is dry and you're drinking water to thirst, your skin being dry probably has nothing to do with you being dehydrated. Now, I mean, certainly your skin being just dry does definitely imply that the skin is dehydrated. That just doesn't necessarily have anything to do with systemic dehydration. So dry skin is more often than not a result of a dysfunctional skin barrier that is allowing water to evaporate from the skin rather than stay in the skin hydrated. Jeff adds that it's drier than normal in the moments after drinking excess water. I get that. I just don't know what the mechanism is. I just don't know what the mechanism is. I don't know. I'm sure there's a mechanism by which drinking too much water could dehydrate the skin. I mean, certainly it's going to physiologically elicit the impulse to remove the water from the body, and you could have some slight overcompensation from that. But that's the problem you get into when you drink water for some other reason than you're thirsty. So I believe in drinking to thirst. And there are exceptions to that. The thirst mechanism can go wrong. But for most people, I overwhelmingly think the right thing to do is to drink water to thirst. All right. Thank you, Jeff, for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.